Bunny starts a story and Turtle draws a map. We have been building our village called Swanford. We have advanced enough that the community is even attracting new people. Well, we have a goblin who looks to show up sometime soon. So, that's new people, right? So, today our colleague Bunny wants to introduce a story idea that she's been working on. This will include new people outside of the people in Swanford we've known. Hopefully they'll come to Swanford sometime. I hope that we are up to whatever Bunny is planning for us. Okay, for now we just want to review that we have what we have explored on recent sessions before we announce any new developments, including Bunny's story. Then we will think about the latest bulletins and play around with these ideas. After that, our friend and co-worker Turtle will show us the work that he has been doing toward mapping out Swanford. So, Turtle has been drawing maps. This should give us a much more solid idea of just how our baby town works, what it looks like from above. And then once Turtle has done his thing, then we can get to some serious brainstorming. We will speculate how our people interact and what sort of stories might grow out of their process. So, it looks like we have a lot to cover, so let's get started.
No. Something interesting happened today. So, what do we already know about today's event? What do we know about the people? What do we know about the place? What do we know about any items that are involved? Obviously, we need to know about people and places and things before we can talk about what will happen next.
And we are Wild Art Fly Free, and we are all about creativity. Eastly is a tweedrill. We learn just how important it is for our young lady halfling to keep her past a secret. She was a child entertainer for dragons, and the dragons don't want her to tell people about it. Eastly has been a neighbor to Tinkle, but it seems like Eastly wants to find a new place to live. At least, she has been talking to the local landlords. Tinkle has been unhappy lately, maybe even cranky. He's also been seen talking to the local mad scientist, Heavy Basher. We have been speculating about what Tinkle might be plotting. Do you think we might find out today? We also know now that the two people of property, the people that own property, the wealthy people, Alex and Dowig, don't like each other. They don't enjoy each other's company. Maybe we will find out why, and hopefully we can learn what sort of people these wealthy humans are.
PX is a person that is made from magic. Magic is science that we don't understand. PX is a magic being, so understanding PX is impossible. Spoiler alert! Reading brings magic into our life, but writing kills the magic. Okay then. One secret that our readers should not immediately understand is that PX is a personification. She will be the representation of a girl's ability to manipulate other people. When we create a character to represent an idea like this, our real character will be able to talk to a part of herself. Would talking to your ability to manipulate other people be helpful? Our girl, Yizi, will never know what PX represents. That's a secret we writers can share only with other writers. So, we will start our story at the end. For us there is no mystery. Let's think about our story as a coming of age for our hero, Yizi. She is a halfling who is learning to be an adventurer and maybe a wizard. She has two friends and associates, Eldon and Pete. During our story, because of PX's skills, Yizi's relationships with both Eldon and Pete will be tested. Yizi won't understand why she feels the way she feels, but she knows that it is her actions that drive her friends to abandon her. So, at the end of this story, Yizi will be at the bottom. She will need to go into her inner cave to face her personal demons. This is when we will all learn that it was PX that was messing with Yizi's feelings. Okay then. This will give us a chance to play with some emotional ideas, like arrogance, sentiment, and self-pity. What other feelings might a young woman feel when dealing with other people, including her friends? Okay then. I think that this story should take the form of a journey. That is often how coming-of-age stories work. Just as Yizi starts the journey with Eldon and Pete, she is discovered by PX. Should we do this part from PX's point of view? It could give us an objective look at Yizi and some sense of how PX thinks. At the start, I don't think PX will have much shape, other than some magic sparkles. As we move along our journey, PX can become more and more attached to Yizi. As she does, she can form a shape that is inspired by Yizi. This will help explain PX's appearance, which we have already created and was inspired by Yizi. Then, after Yizi and PX meet and work out their issues, I think that Yizi could have an ongoing relationship with PX. PX can help Yizi manipulate other people, but only when she is in danger or hurt or maybe really wants something badly enough. Okay then. We can work on this story in the upcoming weeks. I hope that you will offer your suggestions. It really helps my inner feelings.
At Wild Art Fly Free, we have known Yixi and her friends for some time already, so we don't need any extra help building their characters. PX is pretty new, though, so we're very interested in hearing your suggestions for this magic character. And now we should start to build the places that Yixi's group travel on. The the places that Yixie's group travel through as they're coming to Swantford. Interesting situation for planning a trip to Swantford is that right now we don't know where Swantford is. It's somewhere in the continent of Alda, but we don't know where. As it turns out, Turtle is just starting to draw maps for us. He'll be telling us about it just after these announcements. Eastley has asked Dowig about the mansion named Creptic Tower, just outside of Swantford. She was just curious, but Dowig wanted to make sure that Alex was upfront about the problems with the house. Dowig also just wanted a chance to give some digs in at Alex. Dowig is that sort of person. He has insecurities of his own. He is the kind of person who always plays the expert and never admits he is wrong. Alex is also keen to succeed as a landholder, and she also measures her success by her wealth. The main difference between the two is that when Alex fleeces her tenants, she cares about their welfare. She even cuts them a break if they have a good sob story. So, Alex shows Creptic Tower to Eastley and warns her of the strange and nasty magic that seems to be centered on Glenda's well in the front yard. Even more strange than Glenda's well is Eastley's reaction to it. She is not put off at all, and even asks if she could spend some time there to learn what is causing this strange magic. Later, Eastley talks to Tinkle about what she has learned. She knows about Tinkle's shyness and has wanted to reach out to him. An adventure at a scary mansion seemed to Eastley to be a good opportunity to help Tinkle with his shyness issues. She knows that Tinkle is shy, but suspects that he is not a coward. How do you think this will turn out? Would Tinkle saying yes and the two going on this adventure, would this be too straightforward? Something wonky has to happen, right? Good stories are never straightforward. We still don't know what Tinkle wanted the potion for when he hired Heavy Basher to make a potion. Is this going to set a monkey among the wrenches?
So, Owl told us about chaos. She says the best chaos is not random. Owl said that the best chaos is made out of random patterns. That makes sense to me. As a technical-minded person, I spend a lot of effort in looking for patterns inside the chaos. I think that maybe chaos is just a word for really, really complicated, so, that's why I try to look at the world in simpler ways. I try to look at just one part of the world, from just one viewpoint. As a technical turtle, I think in terms of dimensions. Newton had one set of dimensions. Each dimension is a way of thinking of the world from one viewpoint. Newton talked about three dimensions. They are 90 degrees apart from each other. So, yes. When you draw graphs and charts, the 90 degree thing makes sense. I don't know if the universe really works like that, but Newton's dimensions is a good way to break a really, really, complicated world into understandable viewpoints. So, later on, Einstein came up with the idea of making time one of the dimensions. That doesn't make sense at all, unless you need to make graphs and charts. Then it makes complete sense. Anyway, I want to draw some maps to show our new world. We have some random buildings and towns and cities. But, then, a town doesn't grow up randomly. Civil engineers try to make a town or a city that fits its function as a place to live. Even, without engineers, each person who built each of the buildings must have had a little engineer inside their head that was telling them where to put the building and how big it should be.
Public domain. When I joined with Wild Art Fly Free, people told me how important the word free is to our group. So, now I understand what free means. While we are not free to use anything that someone else might own, we all must know, for sure, that everything we produce will be free for anyone else to use. We are giving up our copyright. So, if you want to, you can quote what I am saying and you don't even need to mention that I said it. Of course, you can't pretend that you said it first. So, be sure that you remember, anything that you share with us will become public domain. After that, none of us will have any say about who might use it and what they might use it for.
And then, the topography has to make some sense too. It's not little mental engineers that make those decisions. Mostly it's water. The water erodes the mountains to make their shapes. The water keeps eroding to make the valleys. When the water can, it groups together to have a water party that we call a river or a lake or a sea. The water probably doesn't need an engineer, but if it did, it would just keep saying, "Let's go down. The easiest is downhill." It's sort of like, when Newton invented gravity, the water must have been listening.
Our playground. Building a fantasy world is about creative freedom, but not complete freedom. Total chaos can be fun for a while, but without some sense of progress, absolute freedom becomes tedious. Thankfully, our project provides limits and borders. We must play within the borders of the bits of our world that we have already built. That is one reason that we don't fill in many details until we need to. World details become the borders of our playground. Completed specifics limit our future creativity. So we limit our creative limitations to ensure future space within our creative playground. Unwritten descriptions ensure future room for play.
Well, we have a lot to think about now. That's okay, though. Lots of chaos means lots of opportunities. Maybe we should think about the bigger picture for a bit. We should think about where on the continent of Aldla Swanford is. We can have a look at a rough map. Note that when we zoom in, our scale is very distorted. The rivers wouldn't be nearly this wide, as is shown when we're zoomed in. Also, sadly, this map doesn't show us elevations. But if we remember Turtle's point, the water decides the topography. Rivers tend to flow away from mountains, so where we can see the beginnings of rivers close together, then there are probably mountains there. Swanford is a mining town, and mining towns are often in the mountains. Also, didn't we say at one point that Swanford was surrounded by three mountains? Correct me if I'm wrong. So, where in Aldla should we put Swanford? Please leave your suggestions in the comments.